I am a college football fan. And actually, these have been some pretty good weeks if you're a college football fan in the state of Indiana, because the combined record of Notre Dame, Indiana, and Purdue is 10-0 right now. So we're doing okay. One of the traditions in college football, it's all different this year because limitations on seating capacity and so on, but is what's called a whiteout. What is a whiteout? It's typically a night game, doesn't have to be, but commonly, where everyone who shows up in the stadium wears white. And in the illumination, it is a stunning effect. Suddenly, it's as if the pulsating cheering on of these fans becomes so intense and so encouraging to the team that there is one university, by the way, this is Texas A&M, where they refer to their fans, they've copyrighted this, as the 12th man. The 12th man. Now, there are 11 football players on the field at any given time for one team. And so to have the 12th man be identified with all those fans means that it's as if those fans themselves and their cheering and the intensity that they bring and their encouragement is like having a player almost on the field, the 12th man, part of the action. I had a conversation about this whole A&M experience with a good priest friend of mine, and he commented on the following. So let me draw the connection. What is the image that we're given in the book of Revelations for saints? What do we hear today will be the vision of what is to come. Now listen to this. This is St. John having this vision, and he says, I had a vision of a great multitude which no one could count, from every nation, race, people, and tongue. They stood before the throne and before the Lamb. The Lamb is Jesus. How are they further described? Wearing white robes. And they cry aloud, salvation comes from our God who is seated on the throne and from the Lamb. And then all the angels stood around the throne. How appropriate in Holy Angels Cathedral. And then they ask, who are these wearing white robes? Where did they come from? The answer is, these are the ones who have washed their robes, survived the time of great distress, and made them white with the blood of the Lamb. They're the saints. They are those who have gone before us, who have survived the test, and who now are adorned in white, which is a sign of their sanctity. Now, what we're told on this All Saints Day, let's reflect on this. If you go to the book of Hebrews, there's a litany of all those who've gone before us who have been faithful. And it's a testament to their faithfulness. And then in the 12th chapter, we're told what they look like. Since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us rid ourselves of every burden and sin that clings to us, and persevere running the race that lies before us while keeping our eyes fixed on Jesus, the leader and perfecter of faith. So all the faithful people who've gone before us are this cloud of witnesses. They're like the 12th man. You know, it's the giant whiteout, and we're still in the game. In a world that can be messy and full of hurt and pain and suffering, but we're not alone. We are not alone. We are surrounded by this great cloud of witnesses. We are surrounded by the saints who cheer us on. We're also told that this beatific reward that these saints are given is a reflection of the life that they lived here on earth. So today, how appropriate it is that we're given the Beatitudes as the anchor passage in the gospel for how we're called to live, what it means to be a saint. And notice that the reward is always the kingdom of heaven, and the kingdom of heaven will never fully be realized in on earth as it is right now, but in the future age, and as we experience the heavenly reward. The poor in spirit, theirs is the kingdom of God. Blessed are they. Blessed are they who mourn, they will be comforted. The clean of heart, they will see God. Those who are persecuted for the sake of righteousness, theirs is the kingdom of heaven. I could go through the whole litany that we heard already. This is what it means to live the life of a saint, right here, right now. So what is the role of the saints today? I mentioned that they cheer us on. So we look to the saints for a couple different things. One, as a model of their virtue. We look at them and say they lived a holy life. I want to live that life. I want to model myself over the lives of the saints. And secondly, we call upon their intercession. We ask them to plead before the altar of God for us so that we may live the lives God wants us to live, so that their prayers will still be permeating our lives. Now, some people say, of course, well, my only witness, the only one who I'm trying to imitate is Jesus. And that's true. We want to imitate Jesus. But notice that St. Paul says that he invites them and he reminds them that they're imitators of us and of the Lord, receiving the word in great affliction with joy from the Holy Spirit, so that you became a model for all the believers. So he's pointing to those who are faithful in his own time and says, you became a model for others. Elsewhere, St. Paul says, imitate me as I imitate Christ. So Jesus is our Savior, absolutely. But sometimes, many times, it's helpful for us to have examples of how to live that out that are approachable. And so we have such a great range of saints. And we can look to saints of all ages, of all racial and ethnic backgrounds, of all countries of origin, and we can say, I'm trying to follow Jesus. It's good for me to have an example as to how to do that. And so we can have favorite saints. We can have patron saints. We can look at them in different sets of circumstances and say, Jesus is Lord and I want to imitate him, but I'm following with an extra confidence because I've seen how someone else has made it through situations that might be similar to mine, and people that look like me and came from my same background or had a similar set of circumstances or overcame difficulties that I'm facing or whatever it may be. So we can latch on to those saints. We know from the book of James that the prayers of a holy person are powerful indeed. We're told the fervent prayer of a righteous person is very powerful. So, you know, some people, particularly those who haven't been raised or particularly aware of our Catholic teaching, might say, well, why is it that you pray to the saints? And in reality, we're asking the saints to pray with us to Jesus. So whenever we say we're praying to a saint, we're asking them to pray with and for us. And this is what we do in our common life. You know, we find the holiest people that we know and we say, would you pray for me, please? Because we just intuit that there's this closeness to God in their heart by the way they live and the prayer life that they have. And so we say, would you pray for me? And they'll say, yes. So those that have gone on before us, those who are in that great cloud of witnesses, we continue to ask them to pray for us. And so we can call upon their intercession in the same way that we would ask somebody in our own lives for prayer right now. See, that's really how they're with us, like they're still in the game, you know, they're still, they're the 12th man, and some of them are moving us around on the field, whether we know it or not. The angels are there with us. Today, we're blessed to be able to install as pastor and rector of this parish family, Father Michael Sarufka. From the Order of Friars Minor, a Franciscan priest. And so, Father Michael, I will take the liberty of entrusting to you two patrons who I'm sure are already part of your life. One is Michael. There are a number of St. Michaels, but in this Holy Angels Cathedral and on my crozier is an image of St. Michael the Archangel. St. Michael the Archangel should inspire you, and his intercession should be active in your life. He who is a protector and a guide. And as a loving and holy pastor, one who imitates St. Michael is vigilant so that the flock is well cared for, protected and loved and guided. Beautiful, beautiful, appropriate patron saint for this Holy Angels Cathedral. The second one, of course, is your beloved founder, St. Francis. We're blessed, by the way, to have a variety of expressions of Franciscans here. We have some Capuchins, some OFMs, and we're grateful, and I want to particularly thank the Orders of Friar Minor for your province, who have not only entrusted Father Mike to serve as pastor and rector here, but also who are looking to the establishment of a community of Franciscans here, and what a tremendous witness that is. So, of course, one of the inspirations of St. Francis is he was in a dilapidated church, and he had heard the words, "Rebuild my church," as he was looking upon the cross of San Damiano. Now, he interpreted that as like kind of fixing the roof itself, you know? At first, he thought that, you know, like, okay, we gotta, you know, it'd be like saying you gotta do the tuck pointing, you gotta refurbish the walls, like, let's spruce this up a little bit. You have a lovely church, the building needs great attention, but St. Francis, as I know you intuit, realized that rebuild my church, renew my church, was a call to rejuvenate the faith of the people of God, to make them more clear witnesses of Jesus, to strengthen them, to build the family of faith. Beautiful edifices are fantastic. They draw us close to God, but I know in your heart is that vision of Francis, who was able to be a beacon of hope and light to the world that needed hope and light, and who encouraged those around him, his brothers and sisters, to be, as it were, rebuilt, to be renewed. And may Francis inspire you as the expression of St. Francis becomes more clear here in Gary and beyond. This parish is a little bit unique, obviously, because it's the cathedral church. So it's got this chair right there that really I'm the only one who sit in. This is in a special way like the bishop's church. Father Michael is the pastor of this community, but this is always home for me. And I, in a particular way, because as rector, this place becomes a locus of wider diocesan responsibilities as well, have great confidence in your leadership. You've already demonstrated the pastoral skill that you have. And so I'm grateful in a very personal way for your diligence, your love, and your care for the people here. Everyone in this parish family wants to become a saint. That's what we should all want, to make it to heaven. And we do that in the midst of a hurting and suffering world, but we give witness to the hope and the love of Jesus. We show the world that Jesus is alive, that God loves us, that he's there for us, that he forgives us when we fall, that he's got an eternal destiny for us, that we're not alone, that he is drawing us close to him, and how beautiful it is that we've got that spiritual cloud of witnesses interceding for us and cheering us on. May the Lord give us all, through his saints, the kingdom of heaven.